It's my great pleasure to welcome Guillaume Lecuyer as our speaker today in the One World Mind Seminar. Guillaume received his PhD in 2007 with Alexandre Zubakov and at Paris 6. And then I think he spent some time as a postdoc with Shachar Mendelssohn before returning to Paris. And I think, I mean, I'm not listing all the institutions because a lot of times when we met, he's still in the Paris area, but somehow at a different locations. Currently he's at CREST. So he has received numerous awards, for example, a Mark Folk Award at Colt and also a prize for his PhD thesis at the University of Paris. So I think that's why it's a great pleasure to have you here. Let me be just a personal remark that I think he got me interested in the topic, or he was part of getting me interested in the topic, because I think the first time I met him, I attended some summer school as an early postdoc, just moving into the field of at the interface of signal processing and statistics and so on, and randomization. And so I think he was one of the speakers giving me a lot of insight. I remember him telling me about Alice talking to Bob. So, and
that's right. I remember, yes.
So that's why I'm also very much looking forward to learning more from him today. And so Guillaume, the floor is yours.
Okay, so thank you very much, Felix, for the introduction. Yes. So it's not about compass sensing anymore. So after compass sensing, I moved to robust statistics. So I'm going to speak about robustness. So it is a very old statistical problem. You want to estimate the mean of a vector in a robust way. So I will do it using the median of means principle. So there will be some algorithm and some statistical properties that we call minimax rates. And so all these talk are based on a joint work with my former PhD student, Jules de Persin. Okay, so you can interrupt me whenever you want. Do not hesitate. Okay, so what is the problem that you want to study? So let's say that we have a random vector in RD with a mean mu and a covariance matrix sigma, and you want to estimate this mean mu to with respect to some norm, the S norm, where the S norm of vector u is the supremum over all v in S of the inner product between u and v. So S will be any symmetric subset of RD. Okay, so you want to estimate a mean mu with respect to some general pseudo norm. Okay, so to do that, you are given some point, x1, xn in RD. But unlike the classical setup where all the data are IID, so here you have two bad things that happen to this data set. So the first thing is that you have some adversarial corruption. So adversarial corruption is the following process. So imagine that there was some kind of original data set, x1 tilde, xn tilde. This original data set is unobserved, so you don't know it. But it was given to an adversary. Okay, so the adversary is allowed to modify some data up to capital O data in in your data set. And once he has done that, he's giving to you the data set, x1, xn. Okay, so this is called the adversarial corruption model. And really, the adversary can do anything he wants on capital O data in the data set. So, for instance, he can remove the vector with the largest L2 norm, it can duplicate some data. So this is somehow the worst corruption model. So it includes some classical corruption model like the Huber contamination model, or et cetera, et cetera. So this is a very bad corruption model. So on the top of that, even the original data set is bad because it has only a L2 moment. So it has a very bad concentration property. So on the original data set, we assume that they are independent with mean mu, a covariance matrix that are all smaller than sigma. And so you see that to get this assumption, you only need the second moment assumption. Okay, so you see this data set that you receive to estimate mu is very bad because it has been corrupted by an adversary and you have very poor concentration property. Okay, so it starts in a very bad way. So you are given a data set. So this data set, you see, you can split it into two parts. One part which is indexed by I, such that for all I in I, your data are the same as the original one, but you have this corruption. of the capital O, capital O adversary to collected data. Okay, so nobody tells you what is this partition, of course. You just know this, you just have this data set, and from that, you want to estimate mu. Okay, the common common mean of all the X vulnerabilities. Okay, so this is the setup of adversarial collection and L2 elital setup. Okay, so before doing everything, so we want to know what is the best rate that we can achieve in the best case. So this is what we call the benchmark result. And so the benchmark result to Gini statistic, we got it when all the data are IID and Gaussian. So to get the benchmark result, I will assume that the data are IID. So it means that there are no outliers and that they all have the same Gaussian distribution. So they have very good concentration property. Okay, so it means that in this setup, so this is the best setup that we can think of. This is some kind of a universal, we believe that it is a universal setup. So we can prove that with large probability, at least one minus delta, the empirical mean can estimate the mean mu with respect to the S norm at this rate. Okay, so this rate. So in this rate, you can see there are two terms. The first term, which is the complexity term, and this term, which is the deviation term. Okay, so for the complexity term, so the first one, we measure the complexity of the model via L star, which is the Gaussian mean width of this set. Okay, so the Gaussian mean width of the set T is the expectation of the supremum over all X and T of the inner product between G and X, where G is a standard Gaussian vector. Okay, so there are two terms, and the complexity term given by the Gaussian mean width, and this deviation term, where you see there is some kind of a diameter here. Okay, so this inequality comes from a Borel inequality. Okay. So for instance, in the case of L2 estimation, when the set S is just the unit L2 ball in RD, this rate, the one above, is just the classical rate of estimation of the mean in RD, which is the square root of the trace of sigma, plus the square root of the operator norm of sigma times log 1 over delta divided by n. Okay, so this rate is known to be the rate achieved by the empirical mean when you estimate with respect to the L2 norm. Okay. So this is the benchmark result. So the empirical mean achieves this rate. So one may wonder if we can do better. Can we maybe we could combine the data in a better way to get this result? And we can prove that it is not the case actually. So we can prove that for any symmetric subset of RD, okay, whatever the pseudonorm that you are using, as long as the span of the convex L of S span the entire space. Then if you take any estimator, mu at, so this is a vector from RD to the power n to RD, so it constructs a vector in RD. If this estimator can estimate any mu, the mean mu at a rate given by R star with probability at least one minus delta, so uniformly in every mu, so it means that you can estimate any mu with respect to the S norm at the rate R star. So in that case, then necessarily, the rate has to be larger than the rate that we have seen above. Okay, so it means that there are no estimators and can do better than the empirical mean. Okay, so this improves that we got with Jules. So improves the anthropic Clover bound from Lugosi and Mendelssohn. So they had almost the same result as this one, except that the Gaussian mean width was replaced by this anthropic Clover bound, and because of Sudakov inequality, the Gaussian mean width is larger than this anthropic Clover bound. Okay, so this Clover bound is larger than the anthropic Clover bound. Okay, so as a conclusion, we can say two things, that in the best IID Gaussian case, so which is our benchmark model, for a given confidence, this rate is the deviation minimax rate of convergence. Okay, so we call it the sub-Gaussian rate, so it will be our benchmark. Benchmark rate, this is the rate that we will want to achieve below, actually. Okay, and the empirical mean achieves this rate. Okay, so this is everything happens in this very, very nice setup where you have good concentration and no corruption at all. Okay, so our problem now is of a robust mean estimation that we call robust sub-Gaussian estimation of mu is the following problem. Sorry, so is it possible to achieve the sub-Gaussian rate when there are some corruption and when the data are edited. Okay, so this is our setup, and you know, there is an adversary who has corrupted your data set, and the good data have only a second moment assumption. Okay, so it's very far from this setup where there are no outliers and you have very good concentration. Here we only have the L2 moment assumption and there is this corruption. Okay, but still we want to achieve this right as if all the data were Gaussian. Okay, so this is our problem. Okay, so let's see what we can do first in the D one dimensional case. So with respect to the absolute value. So in that case, so when D equals one, we take S to be the interval minus one, one, so that the S norm is just the absolute value. In that case, so the Gaussian mean width, the diameter are all equals to this quantity, the variance. And so the sub-Gaussian rate is just this quantity. So there is only one term. So we don't need to decouple the complexity from the deviation. There is just one term in the case D equals one. Okay, all the difficulty in that case is to achieve the sub-Gaussian rate, square root of log one over delta, even though you only have a second moment assumption. Okay, so this is the rate that we want to achieve in the case D equals one. Okay, so let's see if it is possible to do that, to achieve this rate, if we have only a second moment assumption. So the first paper who did that is a paper from Olivier Catoni in 2012. He proved that so the natural starting point would be to consider the empirical mean. So Olivier Catoni shows that if you have only a second moment assumption, then you cannot do better than Chebyshev inequality. And so the result that you get, that with probability at least one minus delta, the empirical mean can estimate the true mean at this rate. Okay, and you see that you have this rate one over delta. Okay. And it proves that you cannot do better. So there is a reverse direction. You can construct a random variable x with mean mu variance sigma square. So that with probability at least delta, then you have the other direction. Okay, so it means that this rate is the right rate of convergence of the empirical mean with respect to the absolute norm. Okay, so the conclusion is the following, that this rate achieved by the empirical mean, since you know one over delta is larger than log one over delta, it means that the empirical mean cannot achieve the sub-Gaussian rate under only a sub-Gaussian assumption. So you need to do something else. And so the thing that Olivier Catoni did in the same paper was to construct an estimator that can be sub-Gaussian. So I give you the construction, but you construct an inference function, you construct a Z estimator, a solution to this function, the zero of this function, and it proves the following. If the deviation parameter is larger than expansion minus n over 4, if you take this value for alpha, then with probability one minus delta, this estimator is a sub-Gaussian estimator of the mean. Okay, you get the right deviation parameter, even though we only have a second moment assumption. Okay, so this result is interesting because it proves that it is possible to estimate a mean mu at a rate which is a sub-Gaussian rate, even though you only have a second moment assumption. Okay, and you have to do this complicated construction to do it. Okay. So it's possible to do that under only a second moment assumption. Okay, so in the meantime, there was a result from Mathieu Leral and Roberto Oliveira, and where they use the median of mean principle. So this principle is the following. You take k, the number of blocks, which is on the order of log one over delta. You split the data set into k equal size block. So we assume that n can be divided by k, otherwise you can remove some data. On each block, you construct an empirical mean, okay? So you will have k empirical means, and out of them, you take the median. Okay, you end up with the median of means. Okay, so and you can prove that with probability at least one minus delta, this estimator is a sub-Gaussian estimator of the mean. And again, you just need a second moment here. So this median of means principle, you can see it show up in the 90s and the 80s at least four times in computer science and in statistics. Okay, so it was somehow known from at least 40 years, but it was not used a lot, actually. And after the work of Mathieu and Roberto, it came up, this median of means principle was used a lot during the last decade. So after the work of Olivier Catoni and Mathieu Leral and Roberto Oliveira, there was two problems raised by those two papers. So there was first the deviation parameters, they all need to take it larger than expansion minus n to some power. So there was a natural question to know if it is possible to go below that level, to have a very high concentration property. And the two estimators depends on delta, the deviation parameter. So there was a question about the existence of a sub-Gaussian estimator independent of delta. So for the first question, can we have this result with very, very high concentration? They prove that it is impossible to go below that level. Okay, so they have a construction showing that you can take only delta from exponential minus n to 1 and not below exponential minus n. Okay, so it's impossible to go below that case, and we will all have our results into that range actually. And regarding the existence of a sub-Gaussian estimator independent of delta, you can do some kind of adaptive scheme, a classical one, which is called the Lepsius method. So I'm not going to enter into the detail, but there is a way to use the data to compute the number of optimal blocks. And once you have done that, you can prove the following, that for any delta in the optimal range, with probability at least one minus delta, this estimator with a data-dependent number of blocks is a sub-Gaussian estimator of the minimum. Okay? So it's possible to construct an estimator which is independent of the deviation parameter delta, but here you see you have to know the sigma, the variance. This is the price for this adaptive schema. Okay, so as a conclusion, so we know that we cannot do better than this range when we want to construct sub-Gaussian estimator. And every time there is an estimator which is dependent on delta, there is a classical schema that can make it totally data-driven. Okay, so this is one of the results of that paper. Okay, so let's turn to the d-dimensional case. Okay, and first we want to estimate it, to estimate the mean with respect to the classical L2 norm. So in that case, the benchmark result, so what we call the sub-Gaussian rate, so the rate that we obtain that when all the data are IID with a Gaussian distribution. So it can be, you can prove that the mean, the amplitude mean is optimal, this is the minimax estimator. So you can prove that it can estimate the true mean with respect to the L2 distance at this that rate that we have already seen above when we took S to be the unit L2 bound. Okay? And the minimax small lower bound holds as so in that case. So this is our benchmark result. So the rate that we want to achieve in the L2 setup plus corruption. Okay? So there are two problems on the three possible constructions. So the two problems in your data set is that it has been corrupted by an adversary. Okay, so there are capital O data in your data set which comes from an adversary. That is, can be anything at all. The adversary is allowed to do anything he wants. And the good data have only a second moment. Okay, so there are the two main issues that we have to solve. And those issues can be solved using three types of construction. Either you don't care about computation or anything, you just care about the statistical optimality and you construct estimator, so a measurable function of the data. Okay, and so in that case, you are interested in constructing estimator achieving optimal statistical property. Or you are interested in algorithm, so it's a computer routine that outputs a vector which should be statistically optimal as well. And which should run in linear time. So linear time in that setup is the number of operations should be n times d, because n times d is the cost for the construction of the empirical mean. So in that case, okay, when you want to compute the empirical mean of n vector in Rd, you have to do nd operation. So we would have to construct an algorithm which has the same computational complexity as the empirical mean, and which achieves the optimal statistical property, even though we are in the averagely corrupted setup and Evitel setup. And on the top of that, if you can have some efficient code associated to your algorithm, this is the best possible case. So in the end, what would be extremely nice is to construct an algorithm which can estimate the mean mu in a robust, which is robust to adversarial contamination, which achieves the sub-Gaussian rate, even though you have only L2 moment, which can run like the empirical mean, that is linear time in ND. And if it can come with efficient code, that would be perfect. Okay, this is something that we would like to do. Okay, so the first paper who worked on that problem was a paper from Stasminsker. So he used the median of mean principle together with a geometric median. So you know, in RD, there are several ways to define the notion of median. So in the paper of Stas used the geometric median. So what he did is he took the data set, he split it into k equal size blocks. On every block, he constructs a mean. okay, an empirical mean. So you have capital T empirical means, and you take the geometric median out of it. So the geometric median is the minimum of the sum over all the L2 norms between X and the box. Okay, so here you see there is no square. If there was a square here, the solution would be the empirical mean. Okay, so we don't want that. So the geometric median is this estimator without the square. Okay. So it proves in the following results, so without outliers, but under only a second order assumption, that if you take k, the number of blocks, to be like log 1 over delta, then with probability at least 1 minus delta, you can prove that the geometric median of means can estimate the mean up to this threshold. Okay. So the good thing with the geometric median is that it comes with an efficient algorithm. You can prove that there is some kind of theoretical algorithm which can be run in linear time, like the empirical mean. The bad thing with that result is that this rate is not the optimal sub-Gaussian rate. So so we need to decouple the complexity from the deviation because this rate is larger than the rate that we want to achieve. Okay, so there is still some room for improvement. So we would like to improve this rate and we would like to add some outliers as well. Okay, so another paper in that direction was instead of using the geometric median, you can use the Tukey median, for instance. So that's what did Chen, Gao, and Ren. So in that case, they assume that the good data are Gaussian. They have a Gaussian distribution and they have some kind of a trivial covariance structure, and they have outliers in the Huber contamination model. So in that case, they want to estimate the mean in a robust way. They don't care about being robust to a moment assumption because they have a good Gaussian data. So they use the Tukey median. So the Tukey median is the point with the maximal depth, Tukey depth, and the depth is that function. So to a point X, it computes the infimum over all variation V of the number of time the inner product between V and X time and X is positive. Okay, so it is also called the half space depth. Okay, so this is the depth. It measures how central is your point X in RD, and you take the point which is the most central, which is called the Tukey median. Okay, and they prove the following. So in this range, so the one from exponential minus m to 1, if the number of data is larger than the dimension, then with probability at least 1 minus delta, they prove that the Tukey median can estimate the mean mu at this rate. Okay, so there are three terms. So the blue term is actually the sub-Gaussian rate when the covariance is sigma square identity. So you see that here this is the trace, here it is the operator norm. So the blue term is really the sub-Gaussian rate. Okay, and there is this extra term, which is the price for data corruption. Okay, and we can prove that there are some information theoretic lower bound, which proves that if the good data are sub-Gaussian, like in their case, they have Gaussian data, then the price for corruption is always larger than sigma times the fraction of outlier. So this is what they have, so it is optimal. But if the good data are only in L2, then you can prove that the price for corruption is larger, this is sigma times the square root of the contamination. Okay, so in that case, they have Gaussian data, so they have good concentration. So the best price that you can pay for corruption is this one. So they have the correct price for corruption. Okay. So from a statistical point of view, it is optimal. You cannot do better than that. On the other side, from a computational point of view, the Tukey median is extremely hard to compute. It is known to be NP-hard. There are some algorithms running in a capital N times D, so it takes a lot of time to compute the Tukey median. But from a statistical point of view, it's perfect.
And can I just ask, sorry, this, yeah. in the definition, so this was, you said it, but it was too fast for me, this I in the definition of the Tukey depth. Could you say what is I again? It says the sum I equals 1 to n, I of, or is this just, one? Is this the characteristic function of this?
This is indicator function. Yeah, that's right.
Indicator
function. So it is 1 when it is true. Yes, that's right.
Okay, it's so, 1, then, okay. That helps. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. Yes, you are counting the number of times you are on one side of the half space. Yeah, that's right. Okay. So the first paper who achieves the optimal rate with the right covariance structure was a paper of Lugosi and Mendelssohn, where they use an estimator called the tournament estimator. So the tournament estimator works as follows. So you have some definition. If you take two vectors in RD, we will say that u is better than the vector v if there are some if there are more than half of the blocks, okay, such that U is closer than those blocks than Z. Okay, so imagine that you have X1 here, one you have some points. You need to find half of the block such that U is closer than V. Okay, and in that case, you will say that U is better than V. Okay, then once you have this definition, you can define for all V the set BV of all U in RD such that U is better than V. So you want, and after that, once you have defined that, you can define the tournament estimator, which is also the canvas estimator. So you take a vector V, which has the minimal diameter of all the vectors that beat V. Okay, so you want to take a vector V having a smaller set of points which are better than V, and you take the one with the smallest diameter. Okay, it gives you one vector in RD, and they prove that with probability 1 minus expansion minus k. Okay, so if you take a delta to be this quantity, you will get k, which is like log 1 over delta. Okay, so this is like the usual deviation that we have seen so far, 1 minus delta. So, and you can, they show that you can estimate the mean mu at the correct rate of convergence. Okay, so this is the sub-Gaussian rate. Okay, so it was the first construction of a sub-Gaussian estimator in the literature, and it holds for only under a second moment assumption. Okay, so they didn't add the outliers, but they could have done it. I think it works as well. Okay, so it was an important result in our in this field of robust mean estimation. So after that, we did.
Sorry, can I just ask?
Yes.
Sorry, can I just quickly ask? This means, I mean, just the fact that we're using these diameters, that means that this definition of beta is not transitive. In the sense that, did I get this correctly? Because it could be that U is better than V, V is better than W, and W is better than U.
I don't think it's transitive like that. Yes, I don't think so. Yes.
Okay, but then, okay, but if there's an argmin.
Yes.
So I'm just saying, like, then there shouldn't be there then be a bet if you're sort of thinking about. The sphere, say, shouldn't there be a best U then, or is this why? Like we're taking the arg min, and so shouldn't there be a minimizer where the diameter is zero, or is this otherwise that whatever vector we say, whatever we were taking, there will be still some U that are better.
If you take the minimum, so what do you mean? You take really the minimum, the one with the smallest diameter. Okay. So, yes, that's right. There will be a set of vector mu here, u, which are better than v hat, because usually the diameter is not zero.
Yeah.
But so usually the diameter, you can prove that it is smaller than the rate of convergence.
Yes,
that's right.
So basically, that it's so it cannot be, because I mean the point is that it's hard to imagine because it doesn't sort of has the reflected regular ordering, I guess. But so the idea is that it doesn't. So there's, you cannot make it zero. Like intuitively, you would say it gets better and better and better, and at some point you reach the best, but there's no best.
Yes, that's right. Yes, I think there is no best actually. Okay. Yes, but on the other side, I think that if you take any U in the set of the best of the one who beats this guy, I think they should be also optimal, those guy, those one. But you cannot do using only this definition, you cannot do find the best of the best. Yes, you need to find the one with the smallest diameter, only that. Yes, it's not transductive like you say. You cannot have that implies U better than V. There is no better for that definition. Yes, that's right. But on the other side, I think that for this set, if you take the set of all the guys who are better than this one, this any point here would be a sub-Gaussian estimator, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so after that, we did also a result like the previous one using our strategy. So with the Mathieu Leral, we introduced some kind of strategy, automatic strategy, which we call the min-max median of means. So which works in learning theory, but you can use it for mean estimation. as long as you define a loss function, so for here, for that problem, we define the following loss function for all u in RD. If you take a point x in RD as well, the loss function of u evaluated at x is just the L2 distance to the square of u between u and x. Okay. So once you have loss function, you can run this estimator, which is based on the following quantity. So the median of means over k blocks of the excess loss function between u and v. Here it is the median of the difference of the loss between LV and LU evaluated on the k blocks. Okay. And what we do in this systematic approach, we take the minimum, one minimum of the maximum over this median of means of the excess loss between V and U. Okay, and so we can prove that even when you have outliers and if you have only a second moment assumption, as long as the number of blocks is larger than the 7 times the number of outliers, then you can prove that with probability at least 1 minus exponential k, you have a sub-Gaussian estimator. Okay, so here it is a result where you have also outliers and evital setup. Okay, and so you see, so there are two nice things because it is a sub-Gaussian rate. Okay, and it is also optimal with respect to the number of outliers because when k is larger than O, the number of outliers, this rate is larger than the price for data corruption. Okay, so the price for data corruption is actually hidden in the rate of convergence. Okay, so we don't see it explicitly because under this assumption that is needed. We need the number of blocks to be larger than at least capital O over 2. Otherwise, you can imagine that there will be one outlier in every block. So if you have k blocks, and if you have a k which is smaller than capital over 2, you can corrupted half of them. And if you take the median of them, the median will be corrupted as well. So you really need the number of blocks to be at least O over 2. Okay, so having this assumption is okay up to the constant. So we need that. And when we have that, the price for corruption is hidden in the rate of convergence. Okay, so from a statistical point of view, it's optimal for the rate of convergence. And also the price for corruption is hidden in the rate of convergence. Okay, and when you see this type of estimator, you know a mean of a max, you can run some kind of code of an alternating gradient descent ascent for this type of estimator, but there is no proof of convergence for this algorithm. Okay. So after all this theoretical work, if you like, some people look at the question, is there a polynomial time algorithm for that problem? Okay. And so the first result about this question was a result from Samuel Hopkins, who used the sum of square relaxation to prove that indeed there is a polynomial time algorithm which can output a vector which is a sub-Gaussian estimator of the mean. Okay, so he was the first to construct this type of algorithm. After that, there was a paper from those people who did some kind of SDP relaxation. And they were able to go below this rate. I don't remember what is this number here, but I think it's something like n to the power 24. So they were able to go below this number of iteration up to n to the power 4 using SDP relaxation. Okay. So we did also some kind of SDP relaxation as well, and we were able to achieve the linear time algorithm between linear time and n squared to the power d. In the paper with Jules, and we also prove that it can work with adversarial corruption. So this paper was working with in L2, and after that, there was a paper using only spectral method. So they didn't use the SDP, some kind of SDP relaxation technique, and they were able to achieve also the same rate of convergence of computational time as we did. Okay, so all the algorithms, those four algorithms, they output a vector in RD such that with a very high probability, you can estimate the mean at the correct rate. Okay, so it's a sub-Gaussian estimator which comes from an algorithm. Okay, so it's a bit different from what you have seen previously. It's not just an estimator which minimizes some complicated function. It comes really from an algorithm, some routine. Okay. The nice thing that we achieve it is optimal from a statistical point of view. They are polynomial time algorithm, but even though they are called algorithms, actually they do not come with efficient code because sum of squares are very complicated to implement, even SDP. So in both papers, this one on this one, we have to do many SDPs at every iteration. So it doesn't work well in practice. And I think that this one could work well, but so far I haven't seen a code on it. So maybe this one come with an efficient code. So I show you only the result coming from the statistical literature. So in the meantime, there was a computer science literature, people from computer science working on the very same problem as we were doing, like people from Deco Nicolas, Kamat Ken, Lee Moitra, Stewart, Le Rao, and Vapala. And the paper what was very important to us was this paper from Chang, Deco Nicolas, and Jay. And they obtained the following results. If the corruption is called epsilon, so the proportion of adversarial corruption over the number of data. If this corruption is smaller than one third, if the number of data is large enough, and if the coarse matrix is smaller than the sigma square the entity, then they prove that there exists an algorithm running in linear time, okay, up to log factor, which outputs a vector such that with constant probability, you can estimate the mean at the optimal price for optimal price for corruption. Okay. So this is, you know, it's a bit different than the result that we obtain in statistics. They care only about the price for corruption. They care only about with constant probability. And they don't care about the covariance structure. They just replace it by the largest singular value. Okay. So when you see that, you can still make some statistics and try to improve this rate, improve the condition on N, and make the probability larger than that. So this is essentially what we did with Jules, and we use the median of means principle together with this procedure to get our result. So I can show you what is the procedure that we did with Jules de Persa. So the algorithm ran as follows. So you have some data, the N data, which are corrupted on L2. You take K a number of blocks. The first step is to construct an equi partition of the data. So you split the data into K equal size blocks. On every block, you compute an empirical mean, okay, from one to K.
In an arbitrary way, or does this equipartition have to satisfy?
Oh, yeah, it's a good question. So usually what we do the equipartition in the loops, and we do it at random. And but it's better not to split it from the beginning, but every time you need to split the data, you do it at random in the loops, actually. Yes, I don't think there is an optimal way to do it. Maybe in a recursive way, we can remove some outliers, something like that. But so far, we do it at random. Yes. So we need to start somewhere. So we take the initial point, which is the coordinate wise median of means. So you just take the median of all your data on every coordinate, and it gives you one starting point. So we are doing the following log D iteration. So we do a descent algorithm. So we need to find a descent direction and a step size. Okay, so for the descent direction, we compute the following matrix MC, which is an approximation solution to this problem. So the maximum over all M SDP matrix with the stress equals to one. Okay, so this is a classical SDP relaxation of the top eigenvector problem. Over the minimum over all weights, so there are some positive weights which sum to one, but they all have to be smaller than 10 over 9k. Okay, so mostly they are all equal of the order of 1 over k, except some of them which will be zero. Okay, so the weight zero should be associated to the outliers. Okay. And so we are minimizing this quantity. Okay, so it comes from this is some kind of SDP relaxation of the top eigenvector problem with some weights. Okay, so once we have done that, we have a solution to that problem. And this is the miracle because it can be done by an efficient algorithm, this approximation solution. We compute the top eigenvector of this solution, and this is going to be our descent direction. So once we have this descent direction, we project all those quantities into this direction. We take the median out of it on minus it, And we take this next step, which is the next descent step, the descent step. Okay, this is the result that we have with Jules. And I can give you the explicit the results. So if you have capital O outliers and L2 assumption, if n is larger than the number of blocks, which is larger than the number of outliers, you can construct an algorithm working in that time, which outputs a vector so that with the correct probability, you can achieve the correct rate of convergence, the Gaussian rate. Okay, so everything is okay. So from a statistical point of view, it's optimal. The data corruption is also optimal. It's nearly linear time. It is between nd and n squared d when k equals n. But it doesn't come with an efficient code because we are doing too many SDPs. We do many SDPs at every iteration. Okay. Okay, so let's move to another result. So now we want to estimate the mean in RD with respect to some general norm. Okay, so the S norm that we could do is just the supremum over S of X in a product with V, where S is any symmetric subset in RD. Okay, so before we were estimated with respect to L2, now we want to estimate with respect to some general pseudo norm. So the first result in that case is a result from Lugosian Mendelssohn. So they are considering this norm on RD. Then they prove that you can construct an estimator, mu tilde n, which depends on the confidence, so that with large probability, you can estimate the mean at that rate. So there are two complexity parameters, the Rademacher complexities and the Gaussian limits, plus the correct deviation parameter. The Rademacher complexity is defined as this quantity. And it was nice because it was an existence result that you can estimate the mean with respect to this norm. Okay, but it's very hard to construct, and you know it's a tournament estimator again. And there was some kind of extra complexity term. So ideally, we would like to keep only this term, you know, the Gaussian mean width plus the deviation, which is the sub-Gaussian rate. But actually, what we will do in the following, we prove that we can remove this rate and just keep the Rademacher complexity. Because in L2, usually in L2, the classical way to measure the complexity is the Rademacher complexity. And when S is equal to B2, you can prove that the Rademacher complexity is actually the Gaussian limit, but only in that case. So usually, when you have only a second moment assumption, this is the Rademacher complexity, which is the classical way to measure the complexity of the problem. So in the following, we will be able to remove this quantity and to construct an estimator, which is the solution to a convex program. Okay, this is what we did with Jules. So we can construct a convex program which achieves which can estimate the mean in a robust way with respect to this norm. So by using the following construction. So it starts with the Fenchel-Lejeune transform of a function f. So if you have a function f from RD to R, a set S, so the Fenchel-Lejeune transform is a function which at any mu computes the supremum over all V in S of this inner product minus f. So the only thing we are using from Fenchel-Lejeune transform is that they are convex function. You know, they are the sup of affine function, so it's a convex function. We define two functions, the f and g function, which is the following. To a vector v, you project in this direction v all the blocks, okay, and you take only the interquartile of those projection. Okay, you start from k plus 1 to over 4 to 3k plus 1 over 4, and you average those interquartile quantity. Okay, so when there is a star here, it means that I am rearranging the vector in the order. So A1 star is the smallest one, AK star is the largest one. And here I am keeping only the one in the middle, K over two in the middle. Okay, and after I average. This is the F function. And the G function just takes the median of this quantity. Okay, so we do have two functions. And the key point is that we don't use the data, but we are using the means. Again, so we do the median of means principle. So we split the data into k blocks. On every blocks, we compute an empirical mean. We do have k empirical means. And what we do, we are minimizing the Fenchel-Lejeune transform of this function on that one. Okay, and we are going to prove that they can achieve good statistical properties. And the nice thing is that because function Legendre transform are convex function, when you take the minimum of them, those two estimators are the minimum of a convex function. So it doesn't mean that you can do an efficient cut because they are convex function. Actually, it's very hard because computing the gradient of this function is very hard. But still, it's they are solution to a convex function, which is a bit better than what was known before. Okay. So for instance, when S is B1, you can prove that this estimator is just the coordinate-wise minimum of means. And when S is B2, this estimator is minimum estimator that we used with Mathieu, Lotan, and Timothy. Okay. And you can prove that during some change of variables, that this estimator, you can write it as a min max without any constraint, so that you can construct an alternating gradient ascent descent step for this estimator. So even though we don't have any proof of convergence of this algorithm. Okay. So yes, so this is this alternating ascent descent step. Not going to use too much time on that. But just to go to the statistical property of this estimator. So to get some properties, you know, it's using the median of mid principle. So the median of mid principle, so there are two words. There is a median, okay, and there is a mean. Okay, so it is based on when you study statistical property of median of mid principle. So somehow you can there are two important concepts, the one of median and the one of means, and you can use the CLT for those two concepts. So for instance, the empirical mean, you know that the CLT of the empirical mean works if you have a second moment assumption. Okay, so this is the L2 assumption. And the empirical median, there is a CLT for empirical median, and it works if the cumulative distribution function of the underlying function has a positive derivative at the median. Okay, so there are two very different assumptions, one which is the moment assumption, and one which says that the CDF of the underlying distribution has a positive derivative at the median. Okay, so somehow it means that the density at the median is positive. Okay. Now this is the type of assumption that we will use. And actually, when you work with median of means, you can assume one of the two and it will work. You don't need the two to work, but just one of the two works actually. So that's why we can consider two types of assumption, either a moment condition, either a regularity at zero of the CDF. And since we work with means, the CDF is the CDF of the empirical blocks. Okay, so I'm not going to enter into the detail, but we can have two setups, either L2 setup or this type of regularity at zero of the CDF. Okay, and in that case, you don't even need mu to be a mean, it can just be a center of symmetry. Okay, so it can work even under just L1 and even below L1. Okay, so I'm moving to the statistical property under the L2 moment assumption. So if we have L2 moment assumption, the rate of convergence that we will obtain is this one. So it is almost the same as the one of Lugosi and Mendelssohn, but without the Gaussian limits. So you see there are two terms, the Rademacher complexity and the deviation term. Okay, so there is no any more Gaussian limits. Okay, so this is Rademacher complexity is really the complexity that we have when we work below some psi 2 concentration property. So in some cases, Rademacher complexity are equal to Gaussian minuits, but in general, they are different. Okay, so everything comes from some metric property of this Legendre Fenchel transform. So you can prove that if the number of blocks is larger than the number of outliers, then with large probability, you can prove the following for every mu. If mu is far from the mean, from the rate of this rate of convergence, then you can prove that the Fenchel Legendre transform is an isometry of this function. Okay, so this function is only the one that we would like to minimize because the minimum is a mu star. So here we prove that it is equivalent. So it is between one times this function and two times this function. So that if you minimize this function, which is what we are doing with this estimator, we can hope that the minimum of this function would be close to mu star. Okay, so this is what we can do. And when you are close to the true mean, you can only say that this Fenchel Legendre transform is smaller than twice the rate of convergence. Okay, and using this isomorphic property, you can prove that under the same condition, this estimator will be a good estimator of the mean with this rate of convergence with respect to this norm. Okay, so this is our technique. Everything is based on some isomorphic property. Isomorphic property of the function that we are minimizing. Okay. And the same works as well if we assume only the property of the CDF, if you have only some regularity of the CDF in zero, here the rate is a bit different because we are using another technique. So in this rate, we don't see the role of sigma here because we use a VC dimension, not a Rademacher complexity. Okay, and when you use VC dimension, usually you are blind to the covariance structure of the matrix. So that's why we are paying a D here, whereas we would like to have the trace usually. Okay, but here the nice thing is that we don't even have a L2 moment assumption. We just have some regularity at zero assumption, and so we are estimating something else, which is some kind of what they call a location parameter. Okay, which is some kind of center of symmetry of the distribution. Okay, and here you need this assumption, the number of blocks has to be larger than D plus U, the deviation parameter plus the number of outliers. Then under this assumption, we can prove that with very large probability, again, this tangential Legendre transform is an isometry between this, it is like that, like the function which measure the distance between you and the star with respect to the S norm. And this happens when you are far from the mean. And when you are close to the mean, you can only prove that the function Legendre transform is more than twice this rate of convergence. And using those two properties, so this one is an isomorphic property of some function, you can prove that you have some good estimation property of mu star with respect to the S norm. Okay? And the nice thing here is that this estimator, so this result holds for any mu, such that you have this quantity. Okay, so you don't need to be adaptive to k, the number of blocks, because it works for any mu between as long as it is smaller than k. Okay, and the price for corruption is this one. You see, it is between the one O over n, which is when k equals n. And which is achieved when you have good in layers, when the good data have a very good concentration property, or it can be square root O over N, which is when K is equals to O, which is when the good data have only a second moment assumption. Okay, so the price for data corruption is in between the best one and the worst one, depending on the symmetry or concentration property of the good data. Okay, so we have this type of result. And here, you know, we do not assume that there is not even the first moment. This quantity can be a location parameter, like some median or this kind of stuff. Okay. So, how much? 20 minutes, okay. So now I'm going to turn to another problem. So it is still the robust estimation in RD. But with respect to some special norm. Okay, so this is this norm. And here we will use another notion of median, which is a style de Nonio median actually. So it is associated to notion of depth. So we will use another notion of depth, use this notion of median, and use the median of mean principle to estimate the mean with respect to this norm. Okay. So why am I using this norm? So what is the best norm that we should use? You know, I show you some result for some kind of general norm. And one may wonder why maybe we could estimate with respect to L2 or to any LP or some other norm in LP. So which norm should we use? And so one way to answer this question is to say we should use the norm which gives you the smallest confidence interval. So the smallest confidence set in RD. Okay, so to know what are the smallest best model when all the data are IID with a Gaussian distribution. So the confidence set with the smallest volume are the ellipsoid, so centered at the empirical mean plus this ellipsoid. Okay, because you can prove that sigma is actually the inverse of the Fisher information. And so there are no asymptotically normal M estimator with a better asymptotic covariance. So it proves that this set, this confidence, when you are centered at the empirical mean with this ellipsoid around it. So R star sigma 1 half B2. Okay, this set is the set, the confidence set with the smallest volume with respect to the Lebesgue measure. Okay. So having this type of confidence set, so you know, saying that mu is in this ellipsoid is equivalent to say that it is close to the mean with respect to this norm. Okay, so the norms that naturally come up from this smallest volume confidence set is this norm. Okay, and so that's why we are going to estimate the mean mu with respect to this norm, because simply it will be the one which gives you the one with the smallest volume, at least when the data are ID. Okay, so on you know, there is also a CLT for in the L2 case, and so you can prove that in the L2 case, when the Fisher information is also sigma, you can prove that the smallest confidence interval are also of this form. Okay, so that's why they are the one which gives you the smallest confidence set from a volume point of view at this time. Okay, so we will use this one. So we can do everything we have done before for the estimation with respect to the S norm when we take S to be this quantity. Okay, but you see when we take S to be this quantity, S depends on sigma. Okay, so but still sigma is unknown. Okay, so of course we could use so we could use the previous estimator, so the one F star F or F J. Okay, but they both depend on S. Okay, so because S depends on sigma, we cannot use them. Okay, so what we will do is the following. So first, I'm giving you what is our target. What is the deviation minimax sub-Gaussian rate? So the deviation minimax sub-Gaussian rate for estimation for the problem of estimating mu with respect to this norm, so this special norm, is the same as usual. This is this quantity, the Gaussian mean width of this set. So when you apply this thing to this special case, you can prove that it is equal to this quantity. Okay, so you see that when S is equal to sigma 1 half B2, the 2 sigma, so sigma 1 half times sigma 1 half B2, it is just B2, and the Gaussian mean width of B2 is just the square root D. That's why there is a square root D. Okay, so in that case, the optimal rate is this one. Okay, so you can prove that those estimators, the ones that I showed you before, can achieve this rate, okay, as long as you can use this set S. But as I say, those estimators depend on S, and since S depends on sigma, you cannot use them in practice. Okay, so we need to do something else. So the time is correct. It's 9:41, or is it?
No, I don't know why it says 9:41. It's 11:30 actually, and so basically that you're more or less at the end of the time.
Oh yeah, that's right. I was a bit surprised. Okay. I see. Yes, I don't know what it is.
I have no idea. I was also wondering it. I also had another presentation that also showed 9:41 for this full time. So it may be a feature of some sort. Of maybe, I don't know what.
This is strange. Yes.
It's 11:30. So basically, you have talked for 1 hour now, which is about the time we typically have here in the seminar. But, yes.
Yes. So the time is. Yes. Okay. So maybe if you want, I can just tell you about this slide, and I will be done after that.
Sure.
Is it fine?
Yeah. It's fine, okay. Because everybody who needs to go can go. That's always the thing about online seminars.
Yes. Right? Yeah. Okay. That's right. Yes. Okay. Okay. Yes. So what we'll use here is another notion of median, which is the Stahl-Donohoe median. So it was introduced at the beginning of the IT. So if you are given n points in RD, the Stahl-Donohoe depth, it's like the Tukey depth, if you like, of a point X is this quantity. So this is the supremum over all direction of the absolute value of the inner product between x and v and the median over all those points. So sorry, it should be z1, zk. Okay, so you project in the direction v the point zk, you take the median out of it, huh? And you compare it to and after the denominator, you just use what is called the MAD, the median of those points. Those points are the inner product between v and vzk minus the median between those quantities. Okay, and if you want, you can. This is a notion of depth, and you take the one with the minimal depth. Okay, and so there be a lot of literature about that median. And here, what we did is just to use the SDO median together plus the median of means principle. Okay. And we were able to achieve the sub-Gaussian rate in this setup. Okay, so maybe I can finish here. And if you want to ask me questions, there are other slides, but we can. I think you get the idea. So usually we take some kind of median in RD, we plug the median of mean principle inside of it, and we try to prove that it is optimal. Actually, this is there is some kind of general philosophy. Okay, so thank you for listening to me. And if you have questions, do not hesitate.
Thanks a lot for the presentation.